I can only say that I try with each photograph to let it stand by itself without any words. And if people get it, they get it. If they don't, they don't. And that's the way it goes.
Jack Rosen has made a life of documenting his perception of the world around him. His photographs have graced the pages of major newspapers and magazines worldwide. But Jack Rosen is less a photojournalist and more an anthropologist, recording life's realities as they unfold before him. His photos tell a story of the human condition. But the most interesting story of all is the man behind the lens.
The work I do implies more sociology and anthropology, in the sense this is what man is today, and this is the way he behaves, and this is what he does. So that it's really a record of my little piece of mankind. This photograph, for instance, is an attempt to say that here are two nice young people in love with each other, and this is what's going to happen. And they're not going to be who they were anymore. And it's a very common condition. I mean, you fall in love and you have kids and then your life is changed completely, and most times you don't know how bad the changes are going to be or how good.
He takes 1,000 pictures to get the one. Nothing is staged, nothing is set up, and I think it's all the way Jack is. He's stark and simple and not a frill person in any sense of the word. He's not charming, he's irascible, and he's wonderful.
My approach to photography is almost zen-like, in that I plan nothing, I look for nothing, I just get up and go. And if it happens before me, hopefully I saw it and I photographed it.
I guess the most famous picture he has is the photograph of a cat sitting next to a snowman. And I once asked Jack, how did he get that? And he said, he sat there for a long time. And sometimes he'll wait for hours for something to happen.
I am socially concerned. In a way, I'm a dinosaur. There aren't too many photographers left. There's no money in being socially concerned. One of my first commercial jobs was working with Bill Levitt, who was at the time building Levittown, Pennsylvania. And it was an exciting time in the sense that he was offering veterans of the war homes for $10,000, and they were desperately needed. Levittown had its problems. One of the problems was the fact that Levitt would not sell to African Americans. African Americans could come out there, they could make application, but somehow or other they were never okayed, which caused a great deal of consternation among certain liberal people in the community, the Quakers. And the story is that they decided to bring in a black family to break this kind of situation. They came, the people were very upset, there were angry meetings, and then the people who lived in Levittown at the time put pressure on the black family to get them out by showing up there every night and making a picnic of it. The good humor man came around and everybody ate popsicles, meanwhile cursing and hollering at this house across the street. Finally, one night, a local policeman was hit by a rock and hit the ground and was hurt, not seriously hurt, but hurt enough to the point where it stopped everything.
And he's an artist in the sense of knowing the moment. He just knows the moment. And you can be there and looking at the same scene, you turn your head, you missed it, he got the shot.
The day that President Kennedy was shot, I pulled into the Levittown Shopping Center. I was listening to the radio. And I said, I want to get to a television set. I walked into the Sears store, which had a bank of television sets, and I photographed. She represented to me the despair that the whole country probably felt. But I tried to capture the feeling of how America felt at that instant. In the 60s, there was a serious threat, or at least an implied serious threat, which they could call the Cuban Missile Crisis, when America discovered that there were Soviet missiles in Cuba. And a lot of manufacturers said, hey, we can sell these things. We got fear working for us. And they put up fallout shelters in various shopping centers around the country. And of course, we realized that these were cheap Quonset hut material that wouldn't withstand anything, no matter how far underground you were. It's capitalism at its worst, you could say, and that it preys on the fear of human beings. But I do believe the corporations have a great deal to say in the way our governments run. They're the major funders of the government. They're the major lobbyists, and they get people elected, and they sell Coca-Cola. I did a lot of work in the 60s with brain damaged, mentally disturbed, physically handicapped kids. I enjoyed doing that. I wanted to help. And I came across this in one of the rooms. A good photograph should not be able to be put into words. I really believe that. I think it should leave you with a vague kind of, oh, or it should disturb you a little, or make you happy a little, or do something to you that makes you think a little. America was so divided in the 70s, and I was interested in that division and in trying to close it if I could, or trying to make statements about it. During the work I was doing in those years, I came across a wall in Philadelphia that had been sprayed with what I thought summed up America at the time. It was just split right down the middle. There was a period in television when it discovered sex, and for a while it was even called jiggle television, which I think was in the 70s. And I personally feel that television, I don't know what the percentage would be, but 80% to 90% of television material is aimed at sex, at getting a sex response. I felt that the media generally was unfair to black fathers particularly. They suggest that black fathers are terrible and leave their kids and leave their wives and don't care. I felt there ought to be some other way, something to show the other side of it, however small it may be or not. I think we're alienated from each other to the point where, we don't communicate well at all. We never did well, but we communicate well, less well now than we ever did. I think a lot of us would like to break that, try to reach out, but no longer know how to reach out to each other. We avoid eye contact today. We're afraid to touch each other. There's more and more of that. It's a concern and interest in people, basically, is what these are. And they attempt to show the things that people run into, the commonality that we all have.
A photojournalist. He's not somebody that poses people.
My photographs are honest because they are photographed as they happen. There is no attempt to change or maneuver or make a statement by moving things around. They happen, I am there, I see them, and I photograph them because I recognize it as an interesting moment in terms of life. Here is a mother with her new child and her husband with either his or her old mother. And these people, I looked at them and I said, these people are really caught right in the middle. They've got to take care of a young child and an old lady. And they have quite a burden on them. And I simply photographed it because it had some meaning for me. And a few years later, it appeared in the New York Times as an illustration for an article on what is called the sandwich generation. People, young people, relatively young people, caught between raising a little kid and taking care of an elderly parent. But I happened to see it and recognize it. And that's so much of photography is seeing what you're seeing, knowing what you're seeing. It's being there, it's being patient. I do this to show people what I saw, you know? I say, hey, look, look what I saw today. And I know you didn't see it because you weren't there, and I want to show it to you because I think you'll find it interesting. I photographed a blind man in Rittenhouse Square in Philadelphia. I was struck by the fact that he purchased a flower that he couldn't see. And it said to me, when I saw it, I said, this is the human spirit. This says that people can overcome anything if they have to. It says to me that people really are wonderful in many ways.
Capturing the moment on film is instinctive to Rosen, and it has become a way of life. His interest in photography developed in 1952 after his wife Florence gave birth to their son Rick. It was Florence who gave Rosen the encouragement and support to pursue photography. She started it all.
We couldn't afford to hire a baby photographer, and she said to me, you could probably do that. Of course, I didn't have a camera. And we went out and bought a $29 camera, and I photographed the child.
He began his professional life as a writer. After serving in the United States Army in World War II, he worked in Philadelphia as an advertising copy chief.
I began to hate it because I found myself being very manipulative of human beings. And I said, you don't want to do this with your life. You don't want to go tell people to do things they shouldn't do or don't have to do just to make some money. And at some point, I quit.
With a family to support and a mortgage to pay, he began earning income going door to door, taking baby pictures. And this marked the beginning of a lifelong passion for photography.
The difference between me and all the other photographers then was that I couldn't afford lighting, so I didn't use lighting. I didn't use anything. I used the natural light. I used what was there. I worked with window light, I worked with whatever. And as a result, the photographs were real as opposed to the studio type. I don't use a flash as any standard part of my work. I mean, flash will destroy what the condition is. I would say 99% of my personal work, I never use a flash. Commercial work, I will occasionally. I will always try to use the natural light. The ambience would disappear. The reality would disappear. It would all be well lit. And that's not the way it was. My attempt when I photograph is to capture what is, including the bad lighting if it's bad lighting, and do what I can with it.
Rosen photos began appearing in publications all over the world. Some of his major photo credits include Life, Ladies Home Journal, TV Guide, and Time. Rosen photo essays were regularly published in Philadelphia's Sunday Bulletin magazine during the 60s and 70s. And a series of environmental photos won recognition from Lady Bird Johnson, wife of then-President Lyndon Johnson. His appreciation for the environment was beautifully depicted in his book, The Face of Bucks, a pictorial essay on the natural beauty of Bucks County. Doylestown's Michener Museum has several of his works in its collection.
Celebrity photography is not something I'm interested in. I was just thrown in with these people over the years. It was very gratifying to meet some of the people. I could never have come in contact with these people if I were not a photographer. There's no way I would have met Carl Sandburg or Grace Kelly or Jim Morrison. In every case on these celebrity so-called assignments, I'd go out and find and take what I could find, and you try to grab something that suggested who this person was in a way. Leopold Stokowski, what can I say? Very intense. He was the creator of what they now call the Philadelphia Orchestra sound. He was an innovator, musical innovator. He was a conductor. He conducted a lot of things. He formed several youth symphonies. He was a major conductor in the Philadelphia Orchestra. And he was very well known in Philadelphia. Gloria Vanderbilt at one time was married to Leopold Stokowski. Backstage, and I photographed her looking happy because she was the poor little rich girl. And she was always, you know, very serious and always in trouble, money this, and people didn't like her because she was so rich and she didn't know who she was. And that's who she was too, I figured. I try to go against the grain maybe sometimes. I try to say there's something else here besides what the paper tells you. Sommelberg was a sculptress. She gained her fame early on in her life when she did the original sculpture for the portrait of Roosevelt that appears on the dime. And I said, hey, that's Selma, because she has such a great feeling for humanity and she helps people and her sculpture's about humanity. George Nakashima, he was an internationally known woodworker, architect. His work was sold all over the world. You'll find much of his furniture is everywhere. His tables, his chairs. He lived in New Hope. That's Andrew Wyatt at home in Chad's Ford. Looking, it's in one of the rooms of his house. Looked out the window and I saw what would be considered a typical Andy Wyatt landscape. And there was an air of mystery about Andrew Wyatt. And I like, there's a feeling, I think, in there of mystery. And these are things you see or you don't see. These are instantaneous. Oscar Hammerstein was like his lyrics. He was a witty, wise, gentle man. And if you know his lyrics, I mean, if you know one of the greatest things I think he ever did, which people don't think so, but you know, he did it, might as well be spring, you know, I'm as jumpy as a kitten in a rainstorm and blah, blah. And it was just, he had such great insight into people and the little things that really count in life, the important things, the small things that we can all relate to. And we say, oh yeah, I remember that feeling. That's what he was able to, that's the kind of person he was. Margaret Mead, the anthropologist who lived in Bucks County, was having a drink with her friend Odette Myrtle, who owned Odette's in New Hope. Odette Myrtle was a Broadway actress, a film actress. They were good friends because they were both very early feminists in a sense, and they recognized it in each other. And they became good friends, even though they're far apart in many ways. I had friends who were interested in promoting groups. And then one morning I heard Light My Fire on the radio. I'd never heard it before. And it had just come out, sort of. And I said, wow, I mean, this is it. And I listened again, heard it again, and I found out it was by a group called The Doors, who I'd never heard of. So we called out there and we got them for some crazy amount of money, a couple $1,000s. We got them into Town Hall in Philadelphia. It was 1967. The Doors was their first trip east. They were in great shape, they were young, it was all new for them. They were still caught up in the excitement of, hey, we're gonna be stars. And they were terrific. Carl Sandburg, the great American poet, he was a wonderful person. I photographed him while he was giving a talk and a little concert. I met him 6 months later and I gave him a copy of the photograph. One day, this photograph appeared across two pages in Life magazine as part of his obituary. And I called him up and said, how'd you get this photograph? Well, what happened? They went down to his home in North Carolina and it was hanging on the wall. It was his wife's favorite photograph of him. And she said, this is Carl Sam, this is my Carl. He has that gleam in his eye. He was I'm an artist kind of thing that so many people photographed him like.
Rosen has a unique ability to capture his subject's inner self.
I began to have trouble with my conscience. I would work for editors at magazines who sat in an office in New York and said to me, you have to go out to wherever it is you have to go, and here's the story. And I would go, and that wasn't the story.
Rosen left the big city work behind and came to work in the artistically thriving community of New Hope in Bucks County, Pennsylvania.
There was an excitement. There were creative people here. There was an exciting theater here. I actually worked for a magazine called the Bucks County Traveler, which was headquartered in Doylestown. We spent most of our working days in New Hope at the Logan Inn at the bar or outside, drinking and putting out a magazine, which is what you did in those days.
He spent 5 years as editor of the local paper, the New Hope Gazette.
I brought my style to the paper. I mean, the paper was filled not with people passing checks to each other or standing around in lines being congratulated. There were the people who lived in town on the street. There were people who never had their photograph taken, and they appeared in the newspaper every week, different ones, doing something on the street, being funny, being this. And people loved it. They thought it was great, and I thought that's what a local paper should do in a community this size. Let's make everybody a star, not just the borough council people. So I had access. I had people who trusted me, people who would not pose for me after a while. They knew I wasn't going to do something bad to them in terms of visually. I mean, they knew that, I don't know, how do you put it, that I cared about them, I guess. And this gave me a lot of entree and enabled me to walk around and photograph people the way they really were. They didn't start acting when they saw me, and they still don't.
Rosen cared so much about the members of this Riverside community that he published a collection of their portraits, his family album.
This community is different from others. I call this kind of one of the last, you might say, free ports in America that I'm able to get these photographs that are an attempt to show more than just their face, but who they are inside, as opposed to the obvious, the outside. And this is what I try to do. Now, I can go for weeks without a real photograph sometimes. But I'm always on the street. I walk around with two cameras. I walk around with an old Leica on my neck and an old Nikon on my wrist. I get a certain amount of pleasure from seeing something in a person's face, capturing it, and then showing it to them, and more pleasure from their reaction, which really makes me pleased. And I give a lot, and I get a lot as a result.
He's a kind of a living, vital activity, and which is going on. If you were to see him right now, you'd see him with two cameras hanging around his neck, and he's constantly taking photographs. Because he's constantly seeing things.
Photography is my life. It's become my life. I didn't know it. I realized it maybe 10 years ago that this is my life. This is not a job, and this is not anything else. This is my life. We've had a musician who's been in town for, I don't know, 5 or 7 years, a man named Mountain John. One of his fans was the lady named Margaret Bogan, who was already well up in her 80s, but went to see him every chance she could at John and Peter's and sat there, even though it was difficult for her to get around. She loved his work. He was kind of bawdy, and so was she. He went away for a year or so. She got very sick. He came back into town, and when I ran into him, he asked for her, and I told him her situation. She was dying of cancer and probably didn't, and he really wanted to see her and come talk to her. And we set it up for him to come one day and just quietly sneak in while she was half asleep, half drugged, and start playing his guitar and approach the bed. And it just did a wonder. It was such a wonderful thing for her. I mean, she looked up and she saw Mountain John there, who she loved and knew he wasn't around. And it was about 2 weeks or 3 weeks away from death with cancer. And he sang to her, and they talked, and then she reached over, and he always loved his beard. She said to John, "I hope you use ivory snow on the beard." It was a New Hope moment. It's what New Hope is about. Whatever it is that hits me, that strikes me, whether it's the face, the expression, the situation, whatever. If it means something to me, and if it's, I feel it says something about people, I photograph it.
He's got a sensational eye. He sees things that the rest of us don't see. I have a box of photographs up front, which we keep here all the time, and they're for sale, of course, of Jack's photographs. And most of them are humorous, but every one is a commentary on life around us and what's going on.
I see humor and irony in a lot of things that other people may not see humor and irony in. I think I take the time to see the story that most of us don't. I just don't think people necessarily have the time to see it, or they may see it and just pass it by and let it go. I try to fix it and show it to other people.
Quirks. He loves things out of context that he captures, just moments of truth that are so strange and bizarre and that you would normally not see. It would just go right by, and Jack catches him.
Humor is not something you can easily explain, I don't think. Either you get it or you don't, or you see it or you don't. It's hard. These are accidental things. You have to see it. You have to be there. If you're not there, it just passes, and it's gone, and no one ever sees it. I have a lot of people in town who thank me, who come over the years to me and thank me and say, "You've opened my eyes."
It's like telling a joke. Who doesn't like to tell a good joke? And Jack likes to share a good picture.
Today, Jack Rosen earns a very modest living photographing locally, which takes up most of his time.
I'm still interested in the same things. I'm still trying to say the same things, like peace and love. I'm a dinosaur. I mean, the world is not too interested in my work today. The major magazines are not too interested in that kind of thing.
At 74, his biggest regret is not having the opportunity, not having the time to go into his darkroom and look at the 50 to 100,000 strips of negatives that he has shot since 1950, the prints he has never even seen. Those negatives are part of the legacy of Jack Rosen, a legacy the world may never have the privilege to see.